From Pacifica, this is Democracy Now!
I feel good. Now get up!
James Brown is dead at the age of 73. Hip-hop activist and media assassin Harry Allen joins us to talk about how the godfather of soul revolutionized popular music. But first, in Nigeria, over 200 people have died in a major oil pipeline explosion. We'll look at the rising tension in Nigeria over who controls the country's oil wealth.
We have to empower themselves by getting together, by standing up, by being ready to stand up, even in the face of hostility, in the face of dangers.
We should be given the right to control our resources, because resource control is our right. We are not begging, it's not a privilege. It's our right to control our resources.
Yeah. We'll speak with the director of the new film, Sweet Crude. She just returned from Nigeria last night. Then Anthony Riddle of the Alliance for Community Media joins us to talk about the FCC's latest move to strip local communities control over public access television. All that and more coming up. Now, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The U.S. death toll in Iraq has now exceeded the known number of deaths in the September 11th attacks. According to the Associated Press, the U.S. toll has reached 2,974, one more than the official count of those who died in the World Trade Center, Washington, and Pennsylvania. The U.S. military is now in its second deadliest month of the year. 77 service members have died. In other Iraq news, British and Iraqi forces attacked a police station Monday, described as stomping ground for militia groups. The Basra police station had been accused of housing scores of human rights abuses. The British military says it intervened because dozens of prisoners were set to be executed. Many of the freed prisoners apparently showed signs of torture. The compound was later destroyed. Meanwhile, the U.S. military has detained what it says are four senior Iranian military officials in Baghdad. The Iranians were seized in a raid the military says was aimed at capturing insurgents. U.S. officials did not release any evidence the suspects were involved in attacks. One of the raids targeted the compound of Shia leader Abdulaziz al-Hakim, who met with President Bush in Washington earlier this month. And in other news from Iraq, Iraq's leading Shia Muslim cleric, Grand Ayatollah Ali Sistani, has rejected a U.S.-backed plan to form a political bloc to isolate the anti-occupation Shia leader Muqtada al-Sadr. The plan was disclosed in a leaked White House memo last month. The proposal would have split the United Iraqi Alliance, the dominant party in Iraq's parliament. In Haiti, at least 9 people were killed Friday in a U.N. raid on the poor neighborhood of Cité Soleil. It was one of the worst outbreaks of violence Haiti has seen this year. The UN force in Haiti says it was targeting armed gangs. Dozens were left injured, including 2 children. This is Cité Soleil resident Alex Seren.
Since 5 o'clock this morning, there has been a lot of shooting by MINUSTAH, a lot of people killed by bullets. People cannot go out to get something to eat because of all the shooting. They are here to kill all of us in Cité Soleil. Lots of people here are still hungry.
In Somalia, the conflict between the internationally recognized government and Islamic fighters who control much of the country has escalated. Islamic fighters are said to be retreating in some areas today after fighting with Ethiopian troops backing the government. On Monday, Ethiopian warplanes attacked the main airport in Somalia's capital, Mogadishu. In Israel and the occupied territories, Israeli Prime Minister Ehud Olmert and Palestinian Authority President Mahmoud Abbas held their first formal meeting Saturday since Olmert's election almost a year ago. Olmert pledged to dismantle a few dozen of the more than 400 Israeli roadblocks across the West Bank. He also promised to release $100 million in tax money owed to the Palestinian government. Israeli officials described the move as conciliatory, but Palestinian lawmaker Mustafa Barghouti said Israel has not met its minimal obligations.
The meeting was absolutely disappointing. It was much less than what many people expected. Sharon, in my opinion, Olmert behaved in a very condescending manner. He's withholding $600 million of our tax money. This is Palestinian money, not Israeli money. He now wants to give $100 million only, and he wants to control how they will be spent.
In Afghanistan, the U.S. military is claiming to have killed the Taliban's military leader in southern Afghanistan, Akhtar Mohammed Osmani. This is U.S. military spokesperson Colonel Thomas Collins.
Mullah Osmani is the highest-ranking Taliban leader we've ever killed. He was the chief of the Taliban's military operations, so his death is very significant and will hurt the Taliban's operations. They will no doubt reconstitute his position. They'll put somebody else in that role who will take a while to get up to speed. But Osmani was an associate of Osama bin Laden, Mullah Omar, and Hekmatyar. He had built up relationships with key figures in their terrorist organizations, so replacing him will be very difficult.
A Taliban representative denied the U.S. account and said Osmani is still alive. In one of his last known recorded interviews, Osmani criticized the U.S. invasion of Iraq and Afghanistan.
We are not terrorists. America used it as an excuse to attack our country, Afghanistan. But even if their excuse is considered correct for a second, why do they then attack Iraq? USA said they had weapons of mass destruction. But did they find the WMDs? No, they did not. And they martyred thousands of civilians.
The UN Security Council has approved a resolution imposing sanctions on Iran over its nuclear enrichment program. This is Alejandro Wolf, acting U.S. representative to the United Nations.
Iran's pursuit of nuclear weapons capability constitutes a grave threat and demands a clear statement from this council. Today we are placing Iran in the small category of states under Security Council sanctions and sending Iran an unambiguous message that there are serious repercussions to its continued disregard of its obligations and defiance of this body.
Iran immediately rejected the UN measure. Javad Zarif, Iran's representative to the UN, said the U.S. and its allies haven't read Iranian proposals for a negotiated solution.
That their sole objective from the negotiations has always been to impose and then prolong and then perpetuate the suspension of Iran's rights in line with their arbitrary and fluctuating red lines. Finding solutions has never been even among the objectives.
In other UN news, the Security Council approved an unprecedented resolution Saturday condemning attacks on journalists and urging combatants to stop targeting media workers. The resolution is the Security Council's first to take up attacks on journalists in armed conflict. At least 55 journalists were killed this year, more than half of them in Iraq. Here in the United States, the Bush administration's Secretary for Veterans Affairs was forced to backtrack last week after he appeared to endorse reinstating the military draft. On Thursday, Veterans Affairs Secretary Jim Nicholson told a news conference society would benefit from bringing back mandatory conscription. Nicholson was responding to a question from a reporter who said the Army attracts a disproportionate number of people of color and poor trying to come out of poverty. The White House immediately dismissed Nicholson's comments. Nicholson then issued a statement saying he does support returning to a draft. Former U.S. Army Sergeant and Iraq War resister Ricky Clausing was released from military detention Saturday, 2 weeks before the end of a three-month sentence for going absent without leave. Clausing turned himself in August after 14 months of going AWOL. You can go to our website at democracynow.org to see our interview with Clausing the day he turned himself in. A federal appeals court has suspended a ruling ordering FEMA to resume housing payments to thousands of people displaced by Hurricane Katrina. The payments were to resume subsidies and subjected to a convoluted application process. But on Friday, an appeals court granted FEMA's request to put the ruling on hold. Close to 4,200 Katrina families will have to wait until at least February to find out if their payments will return. The temporary housing program expires that same month unless extended by Congress or the White House. A play featuring the writings of the late American peace activist Rachel Corrie has been silenced for the second time. The Canadian theater company CanStage has announced it's canceling plans to present the play My Name is Rachel Corrie in Toronto. Corrie was 23 years old when she was crushed to death by an Israeli military bulldozer in Gaza, March 16, 2003. Earlier this year, the New York Theater Workshop drew international headlines when it backed out of an agreement to stage the play. The Theater Workshop cited complaints about the play's criticism of Israeli policy in the occupied territories. It appears similar concerns have led to the Cannes stage decision. In an interview with Variety magazine, Cannes stage board member Jack Rose admitted he'd neither read nor seen the play, but said, quote, "My view was it would provoke a negative reaction in the Jewish community." In media news, President Bush is coming under intense criticism over his latest appointment to the board overseeing federal funding of public television and radio, the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. Last week, the president quietly appointed sitcom producer and Republican supporter Warren Bell. Bell's appointment came over the objections of several members of the Senate Commerce Committee, who'd blocked his nomination. Bell has no public broadcast experience and has written for the conservative magazine National Review. New Jersey Senator Frank Lautenberg said, quote, "This appointment by the Bush administration makes it clear they simply don't care about the integrity or quality of our public broadcasting system." In North Carolina, prosecutors have dropped rape charges against the three members of the Duke lacrosse team. Durham District Attorney Mike Nifong says the charges have been dropped because the accuser cannot remember if a penis penetrated her. Nifong is now charging the three defendants with kidnapping and sexual assault. The three Duke team members have proclaimed their innocence. James Brown, the godfather of soul, has died at the age of 73. He died early on Christmas morning as a result of congestive heart failure caused by pneumonia. Over the past half century, James Brown revolutionized popular music. We'll have more on his life and legacy later in the broadcast. And we are saddened to report the death of Michael Vandeveer. Michael was a leading community radio activist at Kauai Community Radio, KKCR, in Hawaii. Our condolences to his family, as well as the family of Community Radio in Hawaii, on their loss. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. We turn now to Nigeria, where at least 200 people have died after an oil pipeline exploded early this morning in the country's commercial capital of Lagos. It's feared the final death toll could be much higher. The explosion comes at a time when tension has been rising, especially in the Niger Delta, over who controls the region's vast natural resources. Nigeria is Africa's largest oil producer and the United States' fifth largest oil supplier. Last week, two car bombs exploded outside an oil company compound. On Saturday, a car bomb exploded outside the state governor's office in Port Harcourt. The Movement for the Emancipation of the Niger Delta, or MEND, claimed responsibility for the bombing. In an email to the press, the group stated governors in the Niger Delta and other political figures, quote, have acted against the interest of the people of the Niger Delta, sabotaging all efforts at resource control for selfish reasons. Saturday was the first time MEND has targeted a government building in over a year. The group has kidnapped foreign oil workers and occupied pumping stations run by multinational oil companies. MEND has also held four foreign oil workers hostage since December 7th. The group has said the hostages will not be released until the government releases two jailed leaders from the Delta, gives compensation to villagers for oil pollution, transfers control of oil resources to local communities, and provides reparations for 50 years of enslavement by the oil industry. In a minute, we'll be joined by Sandy Siafi. She's a documentary filmmaker who returned last night from Nigeria. But first, this is an excerpt of the trailer of Sandy's documentary, Sweet Crude, a film about the Niger Delta.
The effect of the oil pollution on the water too. You'll be seeing it floating on the river, okay? So people cannot drink this water. And because of the floating effect of this oil that is on the surface, it kills the marine life and the aquatic life. And so you see that people cannot even fish, people cannot do anything. Their livelihood being destroyed.
When you lose everything, you lose your environment, you lose everything. You lose your land, you lose the fertility, you lose the health of the land. What do you have left? Telling people the way forward, and the way forward is peace and prosperity and partnership.
we will come together. As educated and learned people, with the support of even these people here, we will move forward.
Now, when I talk about partnership in terms of the Niger Delta, I speak about the people in the communities, including the women I've spoken with, the youth.
The students are out on their march this morning through town, and they've got placards. One of them says, Obasanjo, which is the president of Nigeria, Obasanjo, out of oil resource control. One of them says, South-South movement for resource control supported by students.
Had some very violent inter-ethnic strife in the area, and when I say violent, I mean really violent. So there are some communities that are no longer in existence because they've been burned down.
For the people of the Ijaw and Isekiri in this area, they decided to build a clinic that the people of the area can use. You know, it was unfortunately during the crisis it was burned down.
You imagine in a situation of conflict, of real war, like we had in this area, and then you're stuck here, and then you have possibly an enemy or two, you know, in two boats out there waiting for you. Can you imagine? I mean, where do you go?
Niger Delta is providing almost one third of the oil that we are producing, and a lot of that oil is shut in because of ethnic unrest. So we have flow stations, pipelines, platforms where we can't produce the oil because of just enormous community unrest.
So begin that move away from chaos and violence and death to life.
An excerpt from Sweet Crude, directed by Sandy Siafi, who joins us now in the Firehouse studio. Sandy is also professor in the Film and Video Communications Department at Central Community College in Seattle, Washington. We welcome you to Democracy Now!
Good morning.
We've just got the news out of Nigeria, this in the commercial capital, Lagos, that at least 200 people, looks like the number could be higher, have died in yet another oil pipeline explosion. Talk about the politics of what's happening in Nigeria now.
Well, Nigeria is the largest producer of oil in Africa, and actually it produces more oil than Iraq and Kuwait combined. And the people of Nigeria have seen none of the revenue from that oil. And so what happens, the danger in the bunkering, which is the word that's used for people who steal oil, some people say it's not stealing because it's the oil that comes from their land and they have no income. So very desperate people will actually get the equipment and go to pipelines and they'll puncture them to take oil and sell on the black market. It's a very complicated thing because you can't just sort of walk up with a drill and do it. You have to have fairly complicated equipment. And the government claims that it's all thieves, but they have to be involved in what's happening because people get in and out of the rivers in huge tankers and past Nigerian Navy. So it's very common that people are stealing oil. It's extremely dangerous, and explosions are not that uncommon. And that's likely what occurred.
Talk about who controls these pipelines and particularly the activism that is going on right now in the Niger Delta.
For the last 50 years, oil has been produced in Nigeria, and that 50 years is also the period of time during which Nigeria has been free from being a British colony. The truth is that the legacy of that colony has the same structure laid on it in terms of the corporate life now. So what happened is that the corporate politics intersected with the existing illegal dictatorships, and those dictatorships were just happy to sign laws that said, okay, if there's oil under your feet, the government and the oil companies own it. So in the last 50 years, what has happened to the people in the Niger Delta is that they have had dredging. They have had a loss of their environment that's unprecedented. In one lifetime, they have no ability to fish, to farm, but all of the oil under their feet is owned in a joint collusion relationship in these what are called venture partnerships between corporations, one of which is an American corporation, Chevron, and several others. Shell is the largest, actually. And they are essentially in a relationship where the government and those oil companies own all of that oil, the revenues of which are almost never seen by the people who are suffering from the consequences of it.
We're talking to Sandy Siafi, who's just returned from Nigeria. Talk about the organization MEND.
MEND stands for the Movement for the Emancipation of the Niger Delta. In Nigeria, there has been activism over the last 20 years that some people may recognize some of the names, Ken Sarawiwa being the most famous activist. He was an Ogoni activist who was executed in 1995. And in his footsteps came some people who began to, instead of believing in nonviolent activism, began to believe in more violent response to their choice of how they would resist what they consider to be the enslavement of their people. There was actually one significant nonviolent protest in 2002, which was led by a group of women who commandeered an oil platform. But in the Niger Delta, the relationship of people who, to us, we would consider to be in very separate categories, students, mothers, elders, those people are all related and all work together. MEND is an outgrowth of the group of young men who have no future, no jobs, who saw their mothers beaten within an inch of their lives on those oil platforms. Some of them were volunteer force members under Asare Dokubo, who has been in jail for the last 2 years, but they really only formed about a year ago. It's almost exactly a year ago that MEND formed, and it formed originally in what is called Delta State. It's very confusing right now because there's a group called MEND that is claiming responsibility for some of what is occurring, but the original members of MEND, who are recognized as MEND by the United States government, Chevron Security, those people are claiming that some of what's occurring is by counterfeits.
And the women, the role that the women have played in this?
Well, the women in Nigeria, as you can imagine, much like in many countries that have been exploited as a one-resource economy, the women have really suffered the most. The infant mortality rate is extremely high, the life expectancy very short, the disease level very high, and these women have suffered. The men often go off to the city to have any income at all, and they're left alone to care for their families. These women came together in 2002 and decided that they'd had enough, and they would paddle wooden canoes up to huge oil platforms and climb on them and actually threaten to take their shirts off, which in Africa is a very big threat. And actually scared, the oil workers said, well, we've been trained for every possible security threat, but we were never trained for hundreds of women to come in here and threaten to take their shirts off. And it was very effective. And for the first time, something called an MOU was signed, which is a memorandum of understanding. And those women were demanding fairly basic things like jobs, some remediation of the environment, water, electricity, healthcare, basic infrastructure that you would expect that if you have $38 billion annually of revenue going to your government, that you would have. And they have none of those things. In fact, they have quite the opposite. They have their livelihood taken away from them. The huge rivers of the Niger Delta used to yield fish that were just enormous. One day's catch could feed your family for a week. Now the fish are, and I've filmed this, I've seen it, the fish are tiny, they have almost no meat, and they're pure poison. They're just soaking up oil, acid rain. So these women have suffered an enormous amount. They commandeered these oil platforms, they got the MOUs signed. Very sadly, those MOUs have mostly memoranda of understanding have largely gone unfulfilled. So many of those women have sons and have through those women's groups and then student groups have said, we have to step this up to another level. I was actually under the impression before I was there this summer that many of the women would take issue with the choice to move toward violence. I was surprised to find that many of them actually feel that that's necessary at this point.
Sandy Siafi, we're going to break, then come back, and also hear a clip of Wole Soyinka, the Nobel Literature Prize winner, talking about his country, Nigeria. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org. Sandy Siafi is the director of a new film she's making called Sweet Crude. She's just returned from the Niger Delta. Stay with us.
Glad you're able to hear him.
It's a joke. You're doing the fly. ship now, but I can dig the new breathing. He ain't no drag, he's got a brand new bag.
Bag here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org. That's James Brown. We'll be talking about him later in the broadcast. This is Democracy Now!. Correction to our headlines. Veterans Affairs Secretary Jim Nicholson issued a statement saying he does not support returning to a draft. But we are continuing with Sandy Siafi, documentary filmmaker, director of a new film called Sweet Crude. I wanted to play a clip of Wole Soyinka. He is a renowned writer from Nigeria, won the Nobel Prize for Literature for his writing. He joined us in our studio in April. This is what he had to say about the situation in the Niger Delta.
Well, some of these companies and the governments that they represent, you know, in some cases, make a mistake when they think that the indigents of the land from whom this wealth is extracted are illiterate, not knowledgeable, uninformed. This is the fundamental mistake which they make. Those who actually live there and whose land is being degraded, whose fishing ponds are being polluted, whose farmlands have been totally rendered useless for farming purposes, whose very air, you know, has been completely toxified by decades of gas flaring. They make a mistake when they think they do not observe the digits of profit, the statistics of profit being turned in by the companies, in other words, to the detriment of their own existence. And so the militancy in the oil producing region has escalated in recent months. You must have heard of hostage taking, and I personally, I'm in a position to tell you that I've participated in the effort to release those hostages, which came to a successful conclusion. So I'm in touch with some of these people, these young people, highly motivated. They're not thugs, they're not riffraffs, as they're sometimes portrayed. They're disciplined, and they are determined to correct decades of injustice, and that's all they're really after. You may disagree with their methods, but believe me, nobody should underestimate the very deep motivation that impels these people.
Talk Nobel Prize winner Wole Soyinka in our studio this past April. Sandy Siafi, he's talking about the original men, the activists. He participated in some of the negotiations around hostage release.
Mm-hmm. As did Aronto Douglas, fairly well-known environmental activist who we've interviewed. I think this really brings up an important question about the role of legitimate resistance movements post-September 11th. It is mass media's inclination to instantly start using the word terrorist, and what seems to be true on the ground right now, for the best of our ability to have just determined what's going on, is that there are some either splinter groups or some people are accusing the Nigerian government, with the support of U.S. intelligence, in intentionally muddying the waters of this resistance movement, which was beginning to get fairly strong pan-Delta support. And as the elections are looming in Nigeria, this would be the first peaceful election if it were to occur in April. The stakes are quite high right now. And having a very strong, legitimate resistance movement gaining some international sympathy seems to be very dangerous to the forces that want continued unfettered profits with absolutely no spotlight on looking at these land use laws.
It's something Ken Sarawiwa was leading before he was executed November 10th, 1995, by the Nigerian dictatorship when he was protesting Shell in Ogoniland. I did a documentary with my colleague, Democracy Now! Producer Jeremy Scahill, called Drilling and Killing Chevron and Nigeria's Oil Dictatorship. What do you think is the role of these oil companies and the responsibility of corporations like Chevron?
Well, since the time that of Ken Sarawiwa's execution, some of their role has been the same, but I think there's some important changes for us to look at in terms of what U.S. citizens can and should be doing right now in a very urgent moment in what we have to call one of the most preventable tragedies in Africa. The role of the oil companies at this point is quite simple, but they talk about it as being very complicated. They are a major player in the future and the current state of this country. They claim, whenever you ask them critically what they're doing, they claim that they should not be involved in the affairs of a foreign nation, which is of course absurd, because they're engaged in influencing the affairs of foreign nations every day. In Nigeria, they literally sit down at the table with the Nigerian government and work with them every day to determine what's going to happen with petroleum use laws, with the environment, with actually how to deal with the resistance itself. So
with the military as their own
absolutely.
Security.
The JTF, which means Joint Task Force, serves as private security forces in essence, occupied villages. These villages are the places where pump stations are literally in the middle of town. Gas flares right next to where people live. And the JTF is serving as security for Chevron and Shell. I will tell you that those companies are starting to hear that because they're right there on the front line, they are behaving as if they know that the time might run out for their ability to produce. In fact, Shell is down 25% in their production because of the unrest. When I was there this last 2 weeks, the night sky, instead of being lit by 7 gas flares, is only lit by 2 because that many facilities have shut down. So the other interesting thing to note is that what the people are seeing is that with these oil facilities shut down, the environment is actually coming back, that there is some relief from some of the acid rain. It's a pretty, you would think that people would say, well, if the oil companies leave, then where will we get any revenue at all? But I've heard many village people say, just fine, just go ahead, leave. We would prefer to see the environment be remediated and go back to fishing and farming.
And so the responsibility of the oil companies, not only there, but they are chartered in the United States. One of the stories that we exposed in 1998 was Chevron bringing in the Nigerian military, who opened fire on protesters who were protesting yet another oil spill. And they killed 2 villagers, critically wounded a third, rounded up others, put them in the notorious Nigerian jails where some were tortured. Part of charters in this country are corporate responsibility.
Mm-hmm. And it seems pretty clear right now that Nigeria is a fledgling democracy, and there's an election coming. It seems clear that there has been, I think, some hope in the corporate world that we still just wouldn't be paying attention. The Niger Delta seems to me one of those top 10 untold stories in the mass media, given the importance of the place and the potential humanitarian crisis. And the fact of the matter is that Chevron should be held responsible by U.S. citizens to behave as a corporate player in the same way they would have to in San Francisco. And they would not be able to behave, we would hope certainly, they would not be able to behave as a player in this way in San Francisco.
Well, I want to thank you very much for being with us. As we're doing this broadcast, we're seeing the numbers mount in the Lagos oil pipeline explosion. It looks at this point like there are at least 500 people that have died. Sandy Siafi, I want to thank you for being with us. Sandy Siafi is the documentary filmmaker who is doing the film Sweet Crude. She's a professor of film and video at the Video and Film Communications Department at Central Community College in Seattle, Washington, returned last night from Nigeria. As we turn south to Mexico, the southern state of Oaxaca, where supporters of the People's Popular Assembly of Oaxaca again took to the streets on Friday, known as APO, to demand the resignation of the governor and the release of political prisoners and the withdrawal of federal police from the city. and 37 countries around the world, protests were held as a day of international solidarity with Apo. Democracy Now! Producer Elizabeth Press was in Oaxaca for the protest. She filed this report.
Some 8,000 people marched on Friday in Oaxaca. People in the march were angry, but they were also afraid. This APO member did not want to be identified.
This march is to show the people, the world, and every society that the Popular Assembly of the People of Oaxaca is alive and present. We have never given up the fight, and we will keep moving forward. We will never give up the call for the resignation of Ulysses Ruiz Ortiz. We have to show that the APO and the teachers of Oaxaca are continuing the struggle.
La Asamblea Popular de los Pueblos Oaxaqueños y los maestros de Oaxaca seguimos en lucha.
La APO soy yo. La APO somos todos.
The march stayed clear of the city center or Zocalo to avoid contact with the state police, who had barricaded all the entrances. Family members held signs of the disappeared and detained. Youth re-tagged freshly painted buildings, and the march ended peacefully in a rally at Danza Plaza. Rene Trujillo is a member of the student sector of APO. He marched despite having been detained and beaten weeks before for his involvement with the popular movement.
Nos asfixiaron a los tres inmediatamente en lo que...
They beat us even though we had been beaten already. We were interrogated. Right away they started asking questions about other people who were participants in the movement, and they tried to suffocate us with plastic bags.
Posteriormente también nos dieron toques eléctricos en varias partes del cuerpo.
Later, they gave us electric shocks in various parts of our bodies, while they continued to ask us the same things, asking us for names and addresses of friends in the movement, asking us who were the leaders of the popular movement, who was running the radio, how many people were at the university radio station. At the same time, they hit us with wet rags so marks didn't become visible. There was an attempted rape. They pulled down one of my friend's pants and tried to rape him. They threatened to kill our families.
This weekend was also the century-old festival of the radish, in which Oaxacans carved, yes, giant radishes. On Saturday, APO held its own alternative night of the radishes, even after federal police tried to shut it down. These radish sculptures depict the conflict between police and the People's Assembly. On Sunday, another 18 prisoners were released from the Oaxacan State Prison. From Oaxaca, this is Elizabeth Press reporting for Democracy Now!
And that's some of the news from Oaxaca, thanks to Elizabeth Press. As we turn now to media news here in this country, the Federal Communications Commission has agreed to change cable franchising laws so that local communities have less control over incoming pay television providers. The vote was pushed for by the telecom giants Verizon and AT&T. The measure passed by a 3-2 vote, with Democratic Commissioners Michael Copps and Jonathan Adelstein dissenting. Critics of the FCC's decision are already planning a court challenge. Anthony Riddle of the Alliance for Community Media joins me now here in our New York studio on our second day here at DC TV at the Firehouse. Anthony, welcome to Democracy Now!
Thank you, Amy. Thanks for having us.
Can you talk about what happened just before Christmas?
I think the public really needs to be aware of the kind of processes that are taking place. You know, we had this whole year and a half of hundreds of thousands of people contacting their congresspeople to let them know that we didn't like the legislation that was going through. There was a combination of local governments, free press, the Alliance for Community Media with the Public Education and Government Access, the consumers groups all fighting to a draw with the telephone companies to protect the public interest. And so the telephone companies, within a month or two, have gone to a body of five people, gotten three votes, and they've gotten everything that they wanted in terms of being able to move in on video franchising without a lot of public interest obligations.
What does that mean for people who are not aware?
Well, for anybody who's watching this on cable or anybody who has cable, you know that that cable runs in the public land, and that the companies that use the public land have to pay a certain amount of their gross revenues, and they have to make available certain resources such as the public education and government channels.
So you mean because they dig up the roads to lay the cable and they have a monopoly, they have to give back these public interest channels.
Yeah, and it's not even the monopoly. It's the fact that that you and I own that land, and that they're doing business on that land, and they need to give the community a little bit of something back in order to do that business. In addition to which, you know, the community you're in makes sure that they don't dig big pits in the middle of the street and leave your lawn messed up or leave wires hanging around. So, you know, the local government has an important role to play.
And so what is happening to these public access TV stations, of which there are how many in the country?
We estimate that there's over 3,000 of them, public educational or government access, one form
known
or another.
As PEG, public education government.
Well, first of all, they eliminated all of our operating funding. All of our operating funding. So, you know, there may be some money available for cameras, but none for people to run the access centers. There's the question, well, let me back up a little bit. The FCC issued a rulemaking on this subject. We all had to comment on it. Nobody gets to see it before it gets passed. It's been passed for a week now, and nobody supposedly has seen it yet. And so you have this really cloistered process that's taking place where the public can't even really oppose it. But what we understand is in the rulemaking is that the new entrant, you know, namely the telephone company, may not even be required to carry the same number of channels, if any channels at all, for the public to use on their new systems.
Can you explain? I'm looking at freepress.net. It says, stop the AT&T giveaway, no Ma Bell merger without net neutrality. And it says that that Kevin Martin, the chair of the FCC, is forcing one commissioner, Robert McDowell, to overlook a conflict of interest and rubber stamp the AT&T merger without safeguards for net neutrality. Now, this is a slightly different issue.
Yeah, well, there's really, I guess, including the one we talked about, there's four issues that are coming up in front of the FCC, this non-elected body that we can't get a handle on, and they're going to decide. One of them was the AT&T Bell South merger. In which, well, AT&T, which used to be Ma Bell, is trying to buy back all of its little pieces so that it can still be the biggest communications giant in the world. And they want to merge, and the FCC is deciding on this. McDowell, who is the newest FCC commissioner, worked for Comtel. And so that's one of the telephone representation groups. And so he recused himself and didn't vote on the merger. So that's one of the issues that's coming up. He did unfortunately vote against the public on the video franchising. We also have media ownership rulemaking, which is coming up, which is, you know, whether these large companies can buy up all the newspapers and radio stations and so forth. And one people haven't paid much attention to in some cases is the women and minority ownership rules are also being decided by the FCC. How do we reach these people? You know, we had thousands of people call. They're not even set up to deal with the public. If you were to call Kevin Martin's office in any large numbers, they wouldn't even be able to handle the number of calls that would come in, because it's typically an industry process that doesn't involve the public.
Does it matter that the Democrats are now taking over Congress? And are these FCC rules that were determined right before, that were voted on right before Christmas, going to be challenged by groups like yours?
Yeah, we're going to challenge them in court. We'll be in court with the local governments, I'm sure, you know, as soon as the rules come out. The Congress, we've seen very strongly worded letters from Dingell, who will be in charge of commerce in the House, and several other members, including the New York delegation. But the problem is they don't have direct oversight. Unless you can get the entire Congress to do something and vote all as one, you know, if they were to get outraged over this snatching of congressional power, then you might see something like that. But the likelihood of that happening or happening quickly enough to make a difference is not very big.
And finally, net neutrality, just in 30 seconds, explain it, and where does it fit into these pictures and the rulemaking?
Well, net neutrality just simply means that if you're going out and you're using the internet, that you should be able to get the information that you're looking for if it's out there, that nobody should be able to block you, nobody should be able to slow it down, and nobody should be able to determine what you see. But the telephone companies, who are, and to some degree the cable companies, who are going to be controlling the physical structure of the internet coming into your home, they want the right to decide who you get to see and what quality that information comes in. And so this just fits in with everything. They want complete control of your communication system. This is a dire time for the United States. I don't think most people see it, and you're not going to see it in the media, but you have several large companies who are taking over the entire communication system. And, you know, if this goes on with this kind of process, it should happen fairly soon.
Well, we're going to be heading to Memphis for the major conference on media reform and broadcasting from there mid-January. We'll continue to follow this issue. Anthony Riddle is the executive director of the Alliance for Community Media. Thanks so much for joining us. This is Democracy Now. When we come back, we'll look at the life of the godfather of soul, James Brown. Stay with us. I'm black and I'm proud. Here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The godfather of soul, James Brown, is dead at the age of 73. He died early Christmas morning, a result of congestive heart failure caused by pneumonia. Over the past 50 years, James Brown revolutionized popular music. He transformed the sounds of soul and R&B. He helped invent the music known as funk. He created the blueprint for hip-hop. He even changed the sound of modern African music by influencing artists like the late Nigerian Afrobeat star Fela Kuti. The Reverend Al Sharpton said yesterday, quote, "What James Brown was to music in terms of soul and hip-hop, rap is what Bach was to classical music." James Brown's various nicknames captured just a part of his larger life persona, the godfather of soul, Mr. Dynamite, the minister of the new super heavy funk, soul brother number one, Mr. Please, 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 and the hardest working man in show business. On Sunday, musicians around the world paid tribute to his legacy. This is the hip-hop star LL Cool J.
He's been a tremendous influence on my life as a hip-hop artist, not only an actor, but a hip-hop artist. There was a point in hip-hop when you couldn't make a record or a song without using a James Brown sample or borrowing a James Brown riff or loop or scream or yell or something like that.
Hip-hop pioneer Africa Bambaataa called James Brown the most sampled artist of all time. The break in his song Funky Drummer became one of the most famous rhythms in hip-hop. James Brown is also remembered by many as a civil rights icon. In 1966, he performed at a special concert in Mississippi soon after the shooting of James Meredith. He often canceled his own shows to perform benefits for the Southern Christian Leadership Conference and other groups. In 1968, his song Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud became an anthem for the civil rights movement. Yet Brown was also criticized when he openly backed the presidential candidacy of Richard Nixon. He later served on Ronald Reagan's Council Against Drugs. Last year, James Brown traveled to Edinburgh to perform at Live Aid.
I'm proud of all my traveling to be up here because this is something that I think is long overdue. I think the fact that we're concerned about people throughout the world. I was in Jakarta about a month ago. People having problems. The ones that can solve it is you and I. We can only let the people of governments know how we feel. But we have to solve it by loving each other.
Offstage, James Brown's name has repeatedly appeared on the police blotter. He was arrested several times on drug and domestic violence charges and served prison time as a teenager and again later in life. For more on the life of James Brown, I'm joined by hip-hop journalist and activist, media assassin, Harry Allen. Harry Allen worked with groundbreaking hip-hop group Public Enemy, a member of that group. Welcome to Democracy Now!
Thanks, Amy.
Talk about James Brown.
Well, I think Al Sharpton's summary of him is appropriate in the sense that much the way the techniques and sounds and arrangements that Johann Sebastian Bach put together went on to influence European classical music and are diffused throughout it. James Brown's ideas are diffused all throughout popular music.
Can you talk about how he affected, I mean, how he really helped create funk, how he influenced hip-hop?
Well, hip-hop is a music that relies to a great extent on using pre-existing musical ideas expressed through recordings. And James Brown put together some of the densest ideas in black music ever made. And so in hip-hop, it's almost like when you go to a James Brown recording, it's like you're finding a piece of ore, something that you can take apart and use in endless numbers of ways because there's so many ideas per fraction of a second in any one of his recordings. If you listen to a James Brown's catalog, you're pretty much going to be hearing little bits and pieces of hip-hop, of the hip-hop idea, repeated endlessly throughout it.
What gave him his strength, his power early on, and then branching out the way he did?
I think, my impression is that his hardships in life, James Brown was born in Barnwell, South Carolina, and in 1928, and then went on to live in Augusta, Georgia. And he had an upbringing and a life that can only be summarized as typical of ghetto youth. And by that I mean people who are poor, who often don't have both parents in the home, who are often uneducated and mistreated. And as black people living under the cloud and conditions of white supremacy, having to find a way. And James Brown found his way through life on the street and then through prison, but he was saved by music. And it was, I think, all of those experiences and the fact that he never lost his connection, as Al Sharpton said, to the common man, that throughout his life, James Brown was not the guy who went to Beverly Hills and married a white woman, though I think he ultimately did, but that he stayed with the people. You could always imagine James Brown as being the kind of guy who, you know, would saddle up to a plate of collard greens and mashed potatoes and chicken and, you know, not have any heirs. And so he kept his common touch. And I think that I should also say he surrounded himself in his music production with extremely capable and powerful sidemen, you know, Pee Wee Ellis and Stubblefield and John Jabo Starks and Maceo Parker and all the rest, who helped refine this incredibly dense, incredibly powerful, polyrhythmic, polytonal sound that is known as the James Brown sound.
His involvement in the civil rights movement?
Well, I was talking to my wife yesterday about the record Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud. And she says that she remembers when it came out when she was a teenager, and it almost sounded dangerous to say, you know, and to this day, James Brown has carved a path in terms of music, in terms of politics, that few have followed. You know, a certain number of hip-hop artists have gone that way as well. But he put down ideas, politically and musically that no one else has taken up, that are unique to him. Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud. You know, I'll Get It Myself. Soul Power. These are all extremely, extremely strong declarations of Black independence and Black resilience at a time when those ideas were really needed in music as the lifeblood of Black culture.
We're talking to Harry Allen, who is a hip-hop activist known as, why Media Assassin?
Because I realized very early on as a writer that my job was to annihilate and kill the ideas that were surrounding me and that were in the popular press.
And you call yourself an aide-de-camp of Public Enemy. What do you mean?
I wasn't in the, I'm not in the group. I didn't get on stage and rap or anything like that. But I was, I've always been around and supportive of and helped and aided in various ways Public Enemy's efforts.
And so how was Public Enemy affected by James Brown?
Oh, Public Enemy wouldn't exist without James Brown. It's that simple. Hank Shockley, Chuck D, as you know, the founders of the Bomb Squad, and Chuck D, the vocalist and architect of Public Enemy, talked about James Brown continuously. We sampled his music. It Chuck has gone on and will probably be heard again during this time of mourning, talking about James Brown and his influence and the power of his music and what it added to, you know, the JBs, the grunt, that squeal on that record was repeated 94 times on one of Public Enemy's records.
What do you mean, for people who are not familiar?
Well, P.E. took the record, The Grunt, by the JBs, which was James Brown's background band, and they sampled it, this, and they repeated it 94 times on the record to give it an insistence and a power that they wanted it to have. So they were pulling from James Brown's power to express some of their own.
And what about the accusations of domestic violence later in his life?
I think it's very sad, and I think that a lot of Black males especially have a very difficult time in the context of the racist system making sense of our relationships with females. I think we have a hard time figuring out what we're supposed to do and how we're supposed to live. And James Brown lived a life where he saw the greatest, he met presidents, you know, presumably kings and statesmen, but was still always a Black guy from, you know, the South who didn't grow up with his parents. And he had to struggle with a huge amount of insecurity, a huge amount of all the demons that afflict people who are famous, rich, successful, but ultimately come from very poor backgrounds.
He died this weekend just after giving out Christmas gifts to kids in Georgia.
I mean, that sounds like the James Brown of legend, the person who was, you know, very much connected with normal people, the community, you know, but was at the same time great.
Well, I want to thank you very much for being with us, Harry. Your favorite James Brown song?
Wow, I'd have to say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud, but there's so many, I mean, so many, and all of them for different reasons, but probably Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud.
Harry Allen, media assassin, hip-hop activist, aide-de-camp to Public Enemy, talking about the
and
life.
I should also say, producer of nonfiction on WBAI, the host and producer of nonfiction on WBAI, which we both love.
WBAI Pacifica Radio.
Yes.
Thanks so much,
thank you,
Harry. Democracy Now! Is produced by Mike Burke and Shrufa Bilkadoosh, John Hamilton, Elizabeth Press, Yoruba Rich, and Aaron Mate, Lee Burek, Jen Utes, and Anna Noguera. Special thanks to Mike DeFilippo and Nick Marsilio as we build our new studios, our engineers. And thanks to Angela Alston, Uri Galed, and Samantha Chambly. Our website is democracynow.org. You can go there to get our daily headlines as well as our media alerts and the transcripts and the video and audio podcasts of our broadcasts. That's democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman. Thanks so much for joining us. Thank you.